It is the height of hypocrisy that we are in this place today where those who claim to be champions for women and who claim to be feminists are actually denying the objective reality and truth that there are differences between men and women, specifically biological, physiological differences. And that's what these athletes are facing, you know, this kind of crazy hypocrisy and this denial of the truth and reality.
As we see a lot of times, both at the state and federal level, how representatives vote, senators vote, delegates vote, how we see the media portray this issue, it seems as if it falls on party lines. But that could not be further from the truth. This extends beyond the political aisle. And that's certainly something I've seen traveling the country, going state to state, talking to women who have been impacted by this in some capacity.
We are here to say that we have had enough.
We should be entitled to competing on the basis of sex and without facing discrimination. But again, what myself and my teammates and my competitors and girls around the country, high school level, college level, continue to face is blatant discrimination on the basis of our sex.
It is now an act of courage in where we are today in this country to say there are differences between boys and girls and men and women.
I couldn't believe this was even allowed to happen. I remember the look on my teammates' faces, the look of complete and total defeat. I'm using my voice here today in hopes that future generations of female athletes don't have to.
The NCAA has turned their backs on us time and time again, and now the current presidential administration is doing the same exact thing.
It's been over 50 years since Title IX was first passed.
Men can take academic and athletic scholarships away from women. Men can be housed in dorm rooms with women.
Every single time Leah Thomas was brought to a meet on behalf of Penn, a girl was asked to stay home.
As a sexual assault survivor, many policies pushed today completely ignore my experiences and many women like me understand the true impact of ignoring the realities of womanhood. Future generations depend on us.
I'm not aware of a single Democrat in the House of Representatives or the U.S. Senate that has found the courage to stand up and say there is such a thing as a woman, and I will stand for women's rights and equality.
This is about the next generation of athletes and making sure they have the same opportunities, because I know that if this happened to me when I was in high school, I never would have become a Division I athlete.
Do not let the name calling keep you quiet. It's designed to keep you quiet. It's not a real argument. Ignore it. I survived it and so will you.
I am here to help all of you know that you can speak up, to not have fear, and to tell the truth, because the truth is the kindest thing you can say to someone.
And to know that you are the majority if you believe that women's sports should be kept female only.
Sick women's sports!
Goodness gracious, it is very, very good to see you guys. We are thrilled that you are here on your Sunday morning, your Sunday afternoon. I'm sorry, I feel like I should apologize on behalf of the federal government that you guys have to spend your Sunday morning here in this room. But we're here because we know what's at stake. Yeah, here we go.
Thank you so much for coming out, everybody. Good to see you. Thank you. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you, guys.
Go Army.
As I said, we are here because we know what is at stake. We have seen the attack on women. We have seen the attack on objective truth over these past, I mean, in my own personal experience, what I have seen over the past 2 years, but certainly has been going on far longer than that. And so Tulsi, I wanted to start with you. I'm a recipient of Title IX. I got to reap the benefits of what this meant to me. Of course, it taught me how to be a leader. It taught me how to set goals and work to achieve those goals. Ultimately, it's what afforded me to even be able to continue my academic and athletic career. Title IX, as it once stood, of course, it's the federal civil rights law that prevented sex-based discrimination within any educational program that receives federal funding. And of course, I say at one point, because Title IX is no more. Under this current administration, Title IX in its original intent has been entirely abolished. And so Tulsi, I wanted to ask you, you've been in this fight much longer than myself. I mean, pretty broadly, how did we get here?
Thank you, Riley. First of all, for everyone here, everyone watching the live stream at home, I just want to ask you to join me in just giving great kudos and applause. This is Riley Gaines and Sia Li'ili'i, two collegiate athletes. Two collegiate athletes who have benefited from over five decades of Title IX, and two courageous leaders who are standing up for women and girls in sports and fairness and opportunity. You guys are really the shining example of how we fix what is so broken. When I was in Congress, I introduced legislation, it was bipartisan legislation, called the Protect Women's Sports Act, because we saw what was already starting to happen at that time. This was already happening to you, Riley Gaines, back then. But we saw how the intent of Title IX was already being destroyed, how those who claim to stand up for women and girls, those who claim to be feminists, those who claim to be standing for equality, all of a sudden, when it came to having biological males compete against women and girls in sports, they were silent. So our legislation was very simple. It was one page that added the word biological in front of the word sex to make very clear this was the intent of those who passed this historic legislation, and it's up to us to protect it. We were excoriated for introducing this legislation. We were smeared and called all of these different names for having the audacity to stand up for the rights of women like Riley and Sia. And I just want to say, it's been almost 5 years, I think, since we introduced that legislation, and it is so critical that we are inspired by the example of these brave young women here, because that's how we have to fix what Joe Biden and Kamala Harris have destroyed.
Absolutely, and as you heard, I'm on stage with two beautiful Hawaiian women. As you heard, this is Sia Li'ili'i. She is from the University of Nevada. She's on their women's volleyball team. I'll let her briefly explain a little bit of her background and how she has found herself on this stage today. Because again, I think it's really important to understand. Of course, I believe everyone in this room, I mean, you can wrap your mind around the unfairness of it. But what you probably don't understand is the emotional toll it takes on you. The emotional blackmail that you are faced with from your university, from the institutional level. And so Sia, tell us a little bit about your background and what you have had to overcome to be here on this stage today.
Hello everyone. As I said, my name is Sia Li'ili'i, and I'm a Division I athlete. And this is something that I dreamt of as a little girl. I started playing volleyball when I was 8 years old. I come from a big Samoan family, and my older siblings played sports. My dad's a football coach, so I always wanted to exceed in sports, but I was blindsided by the fact that I had to play against a biological male. And the fact that my university didn't support me in this decision to take a stand was emotional warfare is what I could describe it as. There's not much words that you can put behind that, the meetings, the countless meetings that my teammates and I were drugged into, telling us that we're not educated enough, that we don't know what the science is behind it, that this person was actually at a disadvantage towards us women because they were under all of these drugs. And I'm here today to tell those women who are forced to play against these biological males that you have a voice, so use it, and be courageous, be brave, and don't fear anything.
Just yesterday, University of Nevada was set to play San Jose State University. And if you've been following, it's really become national news now. San Jose State University has a male on their team, taking a scholarship, taking a roster spot, taking a travel spot from a hardworking, deserving female athlete. They were set to play yesterday, but during game time, these brave women, Sia and her teammates, which she is the captain of her team, they decided to hold a press conference. They ultimately decided to forfeit the match, understanding that they would accept a loss. Understanding that they would accept a loss, but they said, look, this is a loss that we are willing to accept because some things matter more than victory. And in this case, our safety does. The integrity of sports do. And so I commend their bravery and their leadership, certainly more bravery and leadership than their administration, their university showed. So thank you guys. Tulsi, we heard the video that everyone got to listen to before we walked out. And there's a clip of you in there saying, I don't think one U.S. senator, one member of Congress that has a D by their name, that is a Democrat, I don't think they found the courage to stand with women. You've spent, of course, four terms in the U.S. Congress as a Democrat. I mean, what is it? Is it fear? Do they really believe that men can become women?
That's a great question that not a single one of them has answered. When confronted with this question, it's happened in front of committees in Congress. Some in the media may ask them these questions. I certainly have asked. And the response that they always give is like, oh, this is a non-issue. Hardly anyone is actually affected by this. I don't know why you guys keep bringing this up, because there are bigger issues that we should be concerned with. I find that to be incredibly offensive and insulting, because there are so many young girls and women like Sia, like Riley, who are experiencing hardship, lost opportunities, lost scholarships because of this. This is not a small issue. And for those, I just find it incredibly hypocritical. Once again, this is coming from a Democrat party, my former party, that claims to be the champion of women. You hear this all the time in this election right now. And it also is the party that says we must believe all women. Why don't you believe Sia? Why don't you believe her teammates? And those who are afraid of being smashed in the face by a male player at full force with a volleyball or any one of the other sports. You're going to hear from a female UFC champion here in the next panel. Can you imagine if she had to go into the octagon and fight against a male? Literally putting someone's life at stake. The hypocrisy is rich. I know that a lot of people are afraid, but really, Riley, they're not answering these questions because there is no logical answer to it. There's no way to explain this. They can't even define what a woman is. So how can they then say they stand with women? And that's really where our responsibility comes into play. As voters, as Americans, as people who care about women, whether you're a man or a woman, is we have to be the ones to hold them accountable. How can we trust having anyone in a position of decision-making and power to protect our young women and girls if in this moment of crisis they are cowards hiding in the corner?
Absolutely. University of Nevada was not the only team in the Mountain West Conference to forfeit their match against San Jose State University. They were actually the fifth team to do so. which tells me, someone again who has really been fighting for this, who's made this my mission for the past 2 years now, we didn't see this 2 years ago, so it tells me that a movement is now in motion. Is that something you feel amongst, you know, and having conversations with your team and the, what did you see yesterday in terms of the outpouring of support within the community?
I mean, the outpouring of support that we received yesterday was amazing. The people behind us have really just made us have this courage to come out and use our voice. I know before we did come out with our own statement against our university, a lot of us had fear because we have scholarships. We have so many things that we're blessed with, but it all could be taken away if we used our voice. And that's something that we thought, but we were proven wrong, which is amazing because of the wonderful things that Title IX brings us.
Absolutely.
If I could just ask you, Sia, your Reno mom is here, and she shared a conversation that you guys had, I think, in an evening before you really went public in making this decision. If you could just share with us what you told her in the challenge that you were faced with and why you felt so compelled to take this stand.
So I talked to my Reno mom, Annie, about this. And I couldn't sleep at night knowing that my nieces, my future daughters, I'm a volleyball coach as well, that I was coaching these girls up to potentially be spiked in the face by a volleyball or to be put in harm's way. I just couldn't stand for it anymore, and enough is enough.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that's a good way to wrap up this first segment here. Understanding we're not doing this for us, for the people who are on this stage. We are doing this for the next generation, for people like your niece, people like my younger sister. Being married 2.5 years, I can only hope to have a daughter of my own one day. That's why we fight this fight. You guys will hear from plenty of other athletes, plenty of other amazing thought leaders who have really been pivotal on this movement, but a lot of the cultural chaos that we find ourselves combating. And so again, we wanted to thank you guys for being here. We have a really, really exciting segment coming up. So thank you.
Wow, we've got drones running around here. I thought, what kind of big bug have you brought to Philadelphia? Hi, everybody. Good afternoon. We are so honored to be here. I feel like I won. I get the biggest panel, which means we have the biggest challenge of staying within time, which I am terrible at. So this is a judgment-free zone, right? Yes. Riley, Tulsi, I mean, hi. My heroes, frankly, and it's, especially Riley Gaines, who's half my age, right? Amazing what these women have done. That's why it's an honor for me, and I know everybody on this panel, to be here. So let's get right to it, because we have a lot to talk about. We could be here for days. We're going to keep it down to 20 minutes. Frank, if you don't know Frank's story, do some homework. We're going to help you a little bit right now, but he is incredible because of where he came from, incarcerated as a teenager, in prison for a year, went on to the National Football League, an all-star player there. The influence that sports had on your life, incredible. Another influence, women. The women in your life. And now Frank is doing something that, ugh, this makes me mad, that more aren't. But he's speaking up based on the influence that women had in his life and also certain coaches like one of our mutual friends, Tony Dungy. What is it, Frank, about the impact that in particular women had on your life that have brought you here today where you had to be here, you made a choice, and you're standing up for women?
Yes, thanks for the question. How y'all doing? Yes, yes, yes. You make me feel like I'm ready to play football again. Oh, yeah. But, yeah, I remember that time my Part 1 coach said, you all take a knee. We was very young, of course. We took a knee. He said, some of y'all will be in prison. Some of y'all will be selling drugs. Some of y'all will be on drugs. And we laugh. He say, you guys, these streets will send you back home to your mom in a body bag or to a prison. And we laugh. Well, you guys, I got bullied at the age of 14 and 15. And I took something that's called a fake ID. It's a picture of you, but everything on there a lie. And I took that fake ID and lived it out after I got bullied because I believed that's what I'm supposed to do to survive. And I found myself incarcerated for a year. As I walked through that jail, I could smell the stinky socks and the paint peeling off the wall. I knew that this is not where I'm supposed to be. As time went on, I got an opportunity to prove my innocence, and I got let go. I got found not guilty, and I went back to school, won all these All-American awards in 1 year in high school. I didn't have the grades, so I went on to junior college in Mississippi. But it's something that's called residue. That residue followed me, and I began to do the same thing that I did in Jacksonville, Florida, in Mississippi at college, and I got kicked out. I'll never forget the coach called my mom and say, hey, this guy is talented, this guy is fast, but we cannot keep him. She said, if you send him home, he'll be dead. She began to cry, and that coach say, I'll try to find him one more spot, and they found me a spot in Kansas. When I got to Kansas, all I was saying to myself, I can't get in trouble, can't get in trouble. And you guys, that residue followed me again. I ended up taking that fake ID again and got incarcerated again. And when I'll never forget bonding out. I went to the president's office, and the president said, you will never touch this field again, but we got to let you go to school because you haven't been found guilty. The coaches wouldn't talk to me. I had no friends, so I would go straight to class. I had a 0.2. And they say, can you try to pick that up? I picked it up to a 3.2. Wow. And I never forget this moment, you guys, that changed my life. Nobody would talk to me, so I walked to the dorm, to my class, to the dorm. And one day I was walking and I heard a voice say, hey, young man. And I looked around, I was in shock, because who's talking to me? I'm the guy they seen on TV. I'm the guy that they would not talk to. And I turned around. It was a janitor. And that janitor said, young man, you walk this way every day. You have a light over your head. I started to laugh. I said, lady, if you knew who I was, you would not be talking to me. She said, no, God told me to tell you you're going to change the world. And you have a light over your head. That lady mentored me, a janitor. How dare we look at titles as our mentors?
And that was a woman who didn't even know you, who took that chance, and that is one reason why you, because from there it's a choice. You chose to change your life. And you have chosen now to speak up for women in sports and obviously in football. I think it's so comical how it only goes one way, right?
Yeah.
Where are the women trying to go play in the NFL and try to bring this guy down? It's not happening. Why? Well, we know why. We'll get there. Point being, you are one of the few, and in the National Football League, everybody knows that this is a no-brainer. Men do not belong in women's sports. Why are there not more NFL players speaking up.
I'll say this. I'll never forget what that NFL scout looked me in the face and say, son, we don't think we can draft you, because he was looking at my past. And I say, don't bring your past into your presence and destroy your future. That's what I started to say to myself. He said he could not draft me. I went home. My mom said, you ready for the draft? I said, I don't think they like me, mom. She said, what God got for you, no man can take away. And I said, okay, mom, you're talking motivation now. And I begin to sit there, and I realize, you guys, I went to that mirror, and I call it the mirror drill. Anytime you discourage, anytime somebody hate on you, I got in front of that mirror, I start talking to myself. I say, listen, you will get drafted. You will make it. You will accomplish something great. See, the mirror is not just to reflect what you see. It's to correct what you see. And see, a lot of men, athletes, they don't want to correct what they see because they're not looking in the mirror. Well, today I'm vowing to make sure, and I empower and encourage them to look in the mirror so they can see their daughter. Because when it rains, we all get wet. And I had to realize, when I stand in front of my daughter and my grandkids and they say, Dad, Papa, what happened back then when Riley Gaines and all of them were standing up for women's sports? What did you do? I want to be able to say, I stood up with her.
Beautiful. And you're doing it. And I need you to keep talking to your former teammates and current team in the National Football League and those coaches as well. They say it to us quietly. They text us. They say it, but they won't say it out loud, and you can have that influence. So thank you, Frank, and for continuing to push through adversity. It's a beautiful thing. Hello, Carla Esparza again. Great to have Carla here. Very recently retired mixed martial arts and wrestler in UFC starweight division. This woman has done it all. And listen, the numbers keep increasing here, unfortunately, but recent data shows men have stolen 1,055 trophies, medals, and titles from female athletes, over 1,000 and counting really every day. Again, you recently retired. Your story with this contact sport, right, with practicing with men, practicing with boys from a very young age. Tell us about that experience and how it has evolved to where we are today, where it's a major issue on an international level.
Well, I have a very unique experience to draw from. I did wrestle on a boys' team in high school, and I competed against boys. And I can tell you with 100% certainty that there is a huge difference. This same year, I didn't even make it past the local league qualifying round to go to CIF. I placed third in the nation in women's wrestling, made All-American status.
Can I repeat that? So third in the nation as a woman, didn't even place with the men, correct?
On a local level.
On the local
correct.
Level.
So I know firsthand what a huge difference there is. So, you know, I just say that we need to stop, especially in contact sports, but all sports, we need to stop putting women's and girls' safety in jeopardy with these backwards policies.
What are the conversations like that you're hearing? Again, just retired from UFC. By the way, you look like you're 22. I love that she's retiring at 22. Goals here. What are those conversations like that you're hearing in your sport as far as this issue?
Well, in my sport, not in the UFC, but in my sport, there's actually been two cases that I know of, Alana McLaughlin and Fallon Fox, fighting against biological women, and they were just destroying these women. I think Fallon Fox, a few years back, fought Tamika Brents and in one round, gave her a concussion, 7 staples in her head, and a broken orbital. And Tamika said that this was by far the strongest person that she's ever fought. So I just emphasize, it's, you know, contact sports, but combat sports, I mean, we're putting people in danger here, and I think that needs to be the focus.
Sometimes, unfortunately, I feel like we have to see those visuals. I mean, it's pathetic. We shouldn't need that to know that this is wrong. But the more and more that we put it out there and show people, maybe the courageousness can begin to vamp up a little bit, because that's what it's going to take, is the people within the sport to say, no, we're not going to participate if it's like this. Hello, Hoyce. How are we?
Life is good in my world.
I love him. To reintroduce you, he's a retired Brazilian professional MMA athlete and a Hall of Famer for the UFC. Science tells us, you know we love numbers, right? Science tells us that men can punch between 30% and 162% harder than a female. It's no surprise, okay? We're talking about boxing here. So let's go back to the Olympics, and it was Iman, the gold medal winner. I forgot the last name. Khalif, yes, thank you, Jensei. There was controversy about this, right? And at the end of the day, Iman was following the rules we thought, but Iman failed a sex eligibility test that only required 2 X chromosomes. He failed that, and that is why there was controversy, and you had all of us tweeting and Riley Gaines tweeting about this during the Olympics, and went on to win the gold medal, which means what? Taking a medal away from a woman. When you watched that this summer, and Iman, someone who could not pass that sex eligibility test, win the gold, what went through your mind?
First thing was my daughter. I have a daughter, 18 years old. She runs track and field, 400. And I was thinking, okay, if there's a guy competing against her, and I called her last night, what would you do? So it's not just in boxing or MMA or in every sport. And she flat out said, Dad, I'll make the biggest scene. I'll get up, stop the whole race, and I'll point out and I'll say, there's no way I'm going to run against a man. And I'll walk away. So I'll go, good for you, girl. Stand up.
You raised her right, for sure. Can I ask real quick what kind of conversations you're having with some of your, you know, the athletes that you competed against in MMA, in UFC? Maybe they're not saying it out loud. Are people like you talking about it behind closed doors, saying, what the heck are we doing?
There's a lot of tough girls out there. They can defend themselves against the average guy. But when you put in a level, the high level, it will be very difficult. So in any sport, so yes, there's a lot of people talking about it, but nobody wants to take a stand. Mm-hmm.
This wasn't an issue when you were at your peak, was it?
There was no such a thing.
Right.
There was no, guys thinking about going to fight with girls. No, it's unfair. Can't do it.
I love that you're raising your daughter, though, to have that attitude, right? Get out there, girl. Fight.
She's a fighter. a runner, but...
Yes. Beautiful. Thank you. Jensei, my dear friend. I know. Wait.
I'm from
Listen,
here.
I picked the casual vibe today because this is one of her XXXY shirts, right? Yes. I love it. It's all I work out in now. Gave it to my girls. They tried to steal some. I grounded them. thank you. And everyone knows Jensei, I think. It's been an honor for me to get to know you. As a former executive at Levi's, you were censored for speaking out. She's been canceled so many times. We have a lot in common with that. First, actually, COVID most recently. I think that's what really put you in the headlines. But before that, Jen was an elite gymnast. And in 2008 was the first gymnast to speak out about the abuse throughout the sport. And now, of course, with this clothing line and just making sure that this remains a conversation, Jen. You can go back to your Levi's days and certainly your experiences now as well. Why do you think corporations are making a choice to sacrifice girls and women? Because that's what it is.
They're cowards. That's the main reason. Most people would rather stand with the crowd than stand apart and do the right thing. That's just a fact. But courage is contagious, right? Why did the governing bodies in gymnastics, the USOPC, the USAG, why did they cover evidence of the abuse by the man we all now have heard of, Larry Nassar, for 30 years? They knew and they covered it up. They thought it was beneficial to their brand to burnish their image by burying abuse. Serial abuse, not just Nassar, coaches across the sport, national team coaches, etc. They only will do the right thing when there is enough pressure to do so. But most people, just like the football players, the corporate executives I know write me quietly and they say, keep doing what you're doing. I can't, but you do it. Well, you know what? The reason I started the brand is because it can influence the conversation. When you show up at the soccer game in that t-shirt or my t-shirt and you have a hard conversation, it lets another person know. Because let me be clear, we are the vast majority. Because most people have common sense and they know that males do not belong in women's sports. They're afraid to say it. They're afraid to get canceled. But if they see you in the shirt or the hat, they're like, oh, I'm allowed to say it? right? Because all we need is the 70, 80% of people that agree with us to stand up and say it. Policy, lawmaking, legislation is downstream from culture, and we have ceded the cultural battle, and we need to take it back. And the people on this stage, and people like you, Sage, and Riley, we are the ones that can drive the change in that cultural conversation, because once all the parents stand up and the athletes, the brave athletes like Sia, the governing bodies, will be humiliated into doing the right thing, and then they'll pretend they always stood with us.
Of course. Of course. Okay. Again, the back channel, the backroom conversations that I know you're constantly having with executives, probably former teammates of yours as well, give us hope, or am I just overly optimistic? How close are we to more corporations doing that? I feel like you've helped make so much progress. Is it still a ways away?
I think we're ways away. I don't think we can be complacent. But look at how inspiring these five volleyball teams are that have stood up and pushed back. And Nevada in particular, because the university didn't support them. And they did it anyway. They're so brave. These young women, if they can do it, why can't grown-ass corporate executives do it? I mean, we're putting a lot of pressure. My tiny little brand is putting a ton of pressure on the big boys like Nike. Nike is the most powerful corporation in sport. They make twice as much money as the NFL, five times as much as the NFL, twice as much as the NBA. I might be getting it backwards. They are the biggest, most influential organization in sport. We're putting pressure on them. They pretend to support women and profit off of that, and they have for 50 years. It's not okay. They do no such thing. They do not support women. They do not support athletes. They never have. So, you know, we're putting pressure on them. They're pretending to ignore us, and that's fine. But we aren't going to stop. I'm a little player. We're making a difference, but we need to get the big boys on board.
Absolutely.
And we have a ways to go.
We do have a ways to go. And I knew not to be complacent. It's like we hope we're making progress by having loud mouths and continuing to get canceled. I'll say this. Did you all see the Nike ad that XXXY posted? I mean, this girl, she's behind that. And that, I don't know how many views that got. Millions. 13 million and counting. Go look on XXXY social channels, Instagram, all of it. But it was beautiful, and it did stir up a lot of conversation. I had people arguing in my timeline about it. And at the end of the day, it takes the loud mouths to not back down. So thank you, and keep doing what
you're doing,
Sage. Girlfriend. Finally, we have Cynthia Monteleone, and I'm going to real quick, because you and I talked about these numbers. She is a world champion in the 400 meters and also a metabolic analytics practitioner. So she's got the medical background as well as the sports background. But we know men run approximately 11% faster than females. They accelerate about 20% faster than females. They throw about 25% further than females. And they, of course, I mean, organs, larger heart, lungs, bone mass, all the above. This is not new news, right? So at the end of the day, those are facts. That's science. We don't want to follow the science now, do we? It's interesting. Leadership in this country, choosing to ignore these facts. Why?
Yes, thank you. Hoist was looking at me earlier because I'm also a 400-meter runner like his daughter. And as well, I'm also a fighter. I had to race a mount. Thank you. I had to race a male athlete back in 2018. I stopped the race, much like his daughter would have done, and I said, why is there a man in my race? I was not quiet then. I was told to be quiet for my own safety, whatever that means. And as you see, 6 years later, I'm still standing up for this issue. So we need leaders that stop pretending. Why is our current administration lying and pretending that they stand up for women when they're trying to rewrite Title IX? Title IX gave the opportunities to me. They gave them to my daughter, who, by the way, in ninth grade, had to run her very first high school race against a boy that just came from the boys' volleyball team. So not only did I have to deal with this, my daughter had to deal with this. And let me tell you, we didn't back down then, and we're not backing down now. So, what can we do? We can tell the truth, and the truth is that men and women are different. We have different bodies. We have different strengths. And by telling the truth and standing up and having courage to keep using our voices, we can make this change. How do I know? Because I bugged the crap out of World Athletics, my governing body for track and field. I created a movement. I gave out t-shirts. We bugged them so much that they changed their policy last year. No longer can men be in the female category in track and field on the world level. So why is the Biden-Harris administration pretending and lying and not telling the truth and pretending that it's okay for men to be in women's sports when the rest of the world knows the truth? I'm going to use my voice to keep fighting. I'm going to use my vote to vote for the administration, the policymaker who will stand up for my daughter, your daughter, and future generations of daughters.
And the thing is, we know for a fact, as research has shown and the polls have shown, almost 80% of Americans agree with that. This should not be a bipartisan issue. This is black and white. These are facts. This is science. And most importantly, by all of us being big mouths and all of you making the choice to be here today, what we're doing is we're hopefully making it so that Sia and athletes like her don't have to be the ones to stand up. How about the big boys, the big girls, the adults in the room, the leadership, do what they're supposed to do and take care of women and girls like they claim. This has been awesome. Thank you, thank you, thank you to everyone on the panel. Cynthia, Jen, Hoyce, all of you on the panel, Carla and Frank, thank you so much for your courage, and we need you to continue to help. Thank you, thank you.
We are athletes. We are coaches. We are daughters. We are parents. We are gay. We are straight. We are pro-woman. We also stand for equality. Equality does not require letting an 18-year-old participate in the 12-year-old category. Nor does it require letting men into women's unique spaces and opportunities. It means treating people with respect and dignity for who they are. Being pro-woman and believing in women's only sports doesn't mean we're anti-anyone. We are both for equality and for women's sex-based rights.
I'm back.
Hi, good morning. Oh, look at that drone. For people who don't know who I am, my name is
There's
Megan
the lights.
McCain.
All right, now yes. We can see each other.
Oh, I kind of liked it in the dark. It was kind of sexy. Thank you so much for having me.
Can I just say the last time we were on a stage together was when you were on The View?
Really? All right, do you want a little juicy gossip since it's just us in here? They were so scared of her, and Tulsi and I were just starting to become friends, and I remember being like, I'm really going to have to do defense for this woman here because they're going to be so mean to her. And then it was like, you can look it up. It was like vultures. So that, and then we really bonded afterward. But you took Joy to task so hard that her husband took a picture of me, and I'm literally like, afterward,
in the commercial break right after that, yeah, like, Megan literally ran over, jumping up and down with joy.
I love that.
So for joyful people, warrior, this one.
Yeah. So for people that don't know, Tulsi and I are, I guess, old friends now for like over 7 years. Yeah. It's crazy. And we became friends through a mutual friend who said, you guys seem like you're a lot alike and you have similar things in common. And at the time I was like, I don't see that at all. And she was like, I don't Same. See that at all. And we basically had lunch. Yep. Yeah. And met and really bonded over being outspoken women of faith, women who love America, women who love the military. And at the time I was living in New York City and working on television show and felt super isolated, and we were supposed to have like an hour lunch, and we got kicked out of the restaurant, and I was like, I love her, she's amazing. And our segment is about equality, supporting equality and sex-based rights, and at the time and still now I have a long history of supporting marriage equality and gay rights, and a long, you know, experience basically since 2012 when it was passed. And my evolution here, I actually was like scared of this issue for a while because it's a one that you get, as you've seen, abused, harassed, societal ramifications. And what really changed for me was becoming a mother. I have two young daughters, one 4 years old, my daughter Liberty, that Tulsi is the godmother of her. Ah, so cute. I know, she's gonna teach her how to surf. And my daughter Clover, who's 21 months old. And I was pregnant when Leah Thomas got all the attention with Riley, and I remember just seeing that what everyone else was seeing and thinking, this is just, I'm living in a science fiction novel, and a science fiction, this is not reality, because I know what I'm seeing with my eyes and my thinking with my brain, and I'm being told something differently. And I started talking to you about this issue, and I just sort of evolved coming out, speaking out quietly, and then louder and louder, and now I'm here with you today.
I think your experience, Megan, is like a lot of people that unfortunately in this time of cancellation and fear-mongering and the threat of maybe losing your job, losing friends, losing family members, the kind of self-censorship that we're seeing is really sad, actually, especially when we look at what's at stake and some of the people that you're meeting and hearing from today who've directly been challenged and suffering as a result of these policies, and why I'm so heartened that more and more people across the country are finding their voice and recognizing that in this moment, if we don't take a stand for women, for girls, and fundamentally for objective truth, then we're gonna lose.
I think for me, I still support everyone's right to live, get married, have the same rights, constitutional rights I do, that anyone else does. But I think what's been a weird evolution for me, and I just turned 40, and I'm very up in my feelings about turning 40, as Tulsi knows, that marriage equality and the gay rights movement was so much about just wanting to join society, wanting to be included like every other civil rights movement. And what's happening now is about taking away from me and taking away from women. And the idea that I have to be comfortable in a locker room with a man undressing in front of me when, again, women's instincts are, if someone is exposing them in front of you, that's a dangerous situation that you need to get out of immediately. And I'm being told that every instinct as a woman, that I should betray that. Yeah. And that I should somehow let my girls be put in a potential place where, I mean, I was talking to a volleyball player backstage that had her face bashed in. She had to go to the hospital, and she has memory problems now. Like, we're putting young women in physical danger, and I'm being told by society that that should be okay. And I can't stand by it, and I don't support it, and I think it's very dangerous, but I also think I think the vast majority of the American public are on our side. I think this is a losing issue for the other side.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And I think a lot of the politicians, I mean, every Democrat in Congress has been essentially silent on this issue when it comes to the women and girls who are being affected by it. And a lot of it is that fear of being kicked out of their own party or becoming unpopular or kicked out of the cool kids club, which is really unfortunate when we should be able to look to our political leaders to exercise leadership. But I think your point, Megan, is a really important one, because so often people who are pushing for this, for biological males to be allowed to compete against women and girls, they do it in the name of inclusion.
Yeah.
But really what they're doing in practice and in effect is excluding women and girls from sports. You know, Riley has talked about, a lot of other people have talked about how we're not trying to exclude anyone, just find a way to make it so, again, if people are making their own choices in their own lives, that's their business. This is a free country. You can live your life however you choose to live your life. But it should not come at the cost of the suffering, in some cases, lives being threatened and opportunities taken away for women and girls. I think that's really it.
I think I've also, yeah, clap for that. It's great. What the question that was on my card is that, why do you think that women on our side are often painted as transphobes or bigots by the media? And I just think it's because they don't have anything else, because it's a scare tactic. It's a way to, I was saying backstage, I think I'm probably the only person that's had a drag queen impersonate them on Drag Race that's here, like present in the building. And I just don't see the two issues as being the same. No. And I think when we're getting into a point where, one thing I've learned, especially like post-COVID, past 4 years, is that when people are saying something to your face, if it's in the media or just, you know, by politicians, whatever, that you know isn't true. Like, we're living in a time where, like, fact and fiction, like, you know, when you see a burning building behind you and it's mostly peaceful protests, to me, this is the mostly peaceful protests of sports. Yeah. There's a burning building behind me and you're telling me it's safe and it's not. And I think for me, I just thought, like, I would be such a hypocrite if I stayed silent, because honestly, if one of my girls was competing, and by the way, my daughter Liberty has been a swimmer, is a swimmer. She's 4 years old. She's already swimming on, like, she surpassed the age of what she's supposed to. She's not doing like the little coach anymore. She's doing the normal one. She's like a great swimmer. We like think this is her sport. And if I were in the situation where I were watching her in a Leah Thomas situation, I would lose my blanking mind. I mean, there would be problems. And so I just felt like it would be so hypocritical of me, who has made my living off of speaking out, to be quiet and scared. And that doesn't mean I don't think you can support your friends in the gay community and support their right to get married and live, but they have to support my right to have safety for my children. Exactly. So I really, this issue has been so hard to watch, because it's almost like a glorification of violence of women. Like, it's like there's a certain segment of society that really likes watching women bleeding. And that, to me, has been the most disturbing element of all of this. But I do think you can do both things.
I want to just, like, underline the point that you made, though, about why is it that they resort immediately to name-calling and smears against women who are standing up for women. It is because they don't have any other logical or rational or science-based, objectively true argument to make. There is no argument. And so, like we're seeing in so many areas of our politics, those of us who are being that child that stands out from the crowd and says, hey guys, the emperor has no clothes on.
Yeah.
They have no response, because we see the truth. We see how insane this actually is. We see how there was a congressman, Mark Sicano from California, who in a congressional meeting was asked, so if Mike Tyson woke up one day and said, I'm a woman, would you support him in a boxing ring against a woman? And without hesitation, this congressman said, yes. Yes. Yeah. Exactly. Any objective, like, rational-minded person would recognize the insanity of that. I can't even call it thinking, because it's not thinking. But we have to... This is where every one of us really does have a very important role to play in our own lives, in our own circles, to have the courage to be that child that says, hey guys, with all due respect, the emperor has no clothes on. Because you never know, by you being the person that speaks up, I guarantee you there are other people in that space, whether it's at your home or in the office or at work or whatever, who wants to speak up but is too afraid, and you will empower them and inspire them to know, like, oh wow, I can do, not only I can do this, but I need to do this.
Yeah. And I think the other question was, do you think that we should fight back against on the war against women? And I think, you know, it can be scary to do these things. Like, I have compassion for people who are like, I don't want to be harassed. I don't want to be doxxed, like happened to Riley. I don't want to have my livelihood impacted. But I think that for me, the other side of this is, if you say nothing, this is only going to continue to get worse. And I don't want women to get hurt. I don't want women to die. I was talking to the lacrosse coach backstage that said if a woman was playing against a male lacrosse player, they can throw a ball up to 150 miles an hour, a woman could actually die. Yeah. So we're talking about literal life and death situation. Yeah. And I think that the water is fine. I actually see a lot of hope in the past, even like year and a half, 2 years. I really think the tide is changing on this. There's lots of data and polling that shows this has been a real red line meat and potatoes issue for voters coming out. And it does not work for the left. I'm sorry, but if Vice President Harris can't say whether or not she's going to pay for transgender surgeries for illegal immigrants, and she can't even answer the question.
And prisoners.
And prisoners, yes. I think that the issue is really shifting. Yeah. And I actually think that there's a lot more people on this side, even if they're scared to talk about
it. Yeah, it's so true. And if you haven't heard about it already, Riley Gaines launched this Protection of Women scorecard that will help provide you with information to share with your friends about the truth about where these incumbent politicians stand, as well as candidates who are running for office. Do they stand with women or not? And I can tell you, every single Democrat in the House and the Senate, Kamala Harris and Joe Biden, not only do not stand with women, they have voted against legislation that has come before Congress that would have provided them with the opportunity to take a stand to protect women and girls in sports. And that really is such a huge defining line in the choice that we all have in this election. Obviously, here in Pennsylvania, you have a very contentious and close U.S. Senate race. The Democrat refuses to stand with women. The Republican is standing with women. And of course, in the presidential race, Kamala Harris and Joe Biden have been worse than silent. Instead of going to Congress and abiding by our way of governance and saying, hey, we want to introduce legislation to redefine Title IX, I think they knew it wouldn't pass. So they backdoored this, made the changes to Title IX, and then even worse, threatened public schools that if they don't abide by these changes, they don't allow boys to play against girls in girls' sports, if they don't allow boys into girls' bathrooms in federally funded schools, then the federal government under the Harris-Biden administration would take away funding specifically in K-12 schools that is normally set aside for poor kids who can't afford breakfast and lunch, this free and reduced funding. When you think about how sick that is, that unless these schools go along with their radical agenda that undermines these girls in sports, they're gonna take away funding for hungry kids at school. So this is the danger and the contrast and one of the reasons why I'm supporting President Trump in this election, because you've seen what they've already done over the last 4 years. You've seen what they've already done over the last 4 years under the Harris-Biden administration. Everything that we've seen on this issue and so many others, it will get radically worse if Kamala Harris is elected, because she will then tell us, the American people, you have given me a mandate to continue the work that they have begun. It will get exponentially worse on every level, and it's up to us to make sure that doesn't happen.
Yes. I know we are almost out of time, but I just want to say, wrapping this up, that I think most women, if you exist in the world, you have some level of pride in being a woman. So I consider myself a third wave feminist. So many spaces I go into, I'm always the only woman.
Tell me, we had this conversation the other day on the phone, because I'm not too up to speed with it. What is a third wave feminist?
It's basically you're for like female equal rights in the workplace and just being treated the same way as a male. And it's basically up until this issue.
Right.
And I am a lot of times the only woman in the room. You're a lot of times the only woman in the room. It's hard to get women in spaces in general. And now you're talking about taking away from athletes who have worked so hard, a lot of times like Riley, like her entire life to get to this place. And we're already not in enough spaces. So to have more of it taken away, I think that to me is like the root of the tragedy of this issue. It's just removing accomplishments, removing spaces that women can be in. And I think this, it's not just because I'm a girl mom, but I really think this is like such a dominant, important issue. I'm so happy to be here with all of you this morning. I know you all had someplace better to be and something better to do on a Sunday morning in lovely Philadelphia. Oh, thank you. Oh, you did not have a, what? Oh, yes, it is important. But church is important too sometimes. Oh, gotcha. Yes, of course. Thank you so much.
No, thank you, Megan. I'm thank you.
What? Tulsi 2028. Yes.
I want to say thank you to
hire that man.
Megan is one of my dearest friends in the world, and I just want to say thank you for coming and joining us here. Thank you all for making time to do this, because we have to save our country, and we have to take a stand for fairness and equality and stand with our women and girls. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So severe, it knocked me unconscious for about 30 seconds in a fencing position. We have no choice but to stand up for women and what they rightfully deserve.
We need to take back Title IX, that we need to define the terms women, that we need to remind everyone in this country that women's sports are for women.
Please tell your friends, every parent, every coach, every athlete, every aunt, every uncle, every administrator. The more people who speak up, the more people have courage.
There are a lot of areas where sex shouldn't be important, but sports are not the case. We have to have separate categories for a reason. Men and women are different, and that's okay.
We just want our rights to be upheld on the court, and we believe that women deserve fair opportunity, and it's just not right.
Through grassroots storytelling and original journalism, IW Features, the storytelling program of Independent Women's Voice, provides unique and personal insight into the biggest issues facing Americans today. IW Features has received over 1,000 stories from female athletes, coaches, and parents who have been impacted by men participating in women's sports. The NCAA has received personal letters from over 7,000 NCAA female athletes demanding its student athlete participation policy be revised to prohibit men from women's collegiate sports. Over 275 golfers are taking a stand for single-sex competition in the LPGA. Five and counting NCAA women's volleyball teams have forfeited their matches rather than compete against a male on the women's squad. This is a growing movement of athletes, coaches, and parents who are Stand With Women champions.
Stand With Women Sports! Yeah!
Thank you, guys. Again, we wanted to thank you for being here, taking time out of your Sunday afternoon to be here. All of you, of course, in the room. Elon Musk just tweeted out the live stream, so there are almost 500,000 people watching this right now. Really amazing stuff, and we want to thank you for standing with women. If our leaders cannot find it within themselves to stand with women, then I say it's time we elect new leaders. We're going to bring some people to the stage. These brave women have all been affected by men playing in women's sports, men stealing roster spots, violating them in the locker room, areas of undressing, stealing titles, stealing opportunities, and endangering the safety and the privacy of women. The first athlete we're going to bring out is Paula Scanlon. She's a former University of Pennsylvania swimmer, an independent Women's Voice legislative liaison. Next, we're bringing out Peyton McNabb. She's the young girl in the video you saw. She is a former high school volleyball player and independent Women's Voice ambassador. Next, we're going to bring out Lauren Miller. She is a professional golfer, and she gained national attention after losing first place title at the 2024 NXXT Women's Championship to a man. We're going to bring back out Sia Li'i. She is the University of Nevada women's volleyball team captain. We're going to bring back out Cynthia Montalone. She is a Team USA Masters track athlete who competed against men in her races. And lastly, we're going to bring out another IWF ambassador, and this is the former head women's lacrosse coach at Oberlin College. These courageous women who you see on this stage today, they have been brave enough to share their stories with America because our leaders aren't standing with us. I want to see every person in this room, every athlete, every parent, and all those who stand with women to stand up while we welcome everyone back out on the stage with us.
Sometimes as we look to times of great challenge and great controversy, and we look to inspiration from leaders like Reverend Martin Luther King and others who stood up for truth and fairness and equality in the face of great danger, sometimes we ask ourselves, what would I do in that moment? This is that moment where we have a challenge and an opportunity to take that courageous step, to be that voice for truth, even in the face of adversity, knowing that the decisions that we make today to have the backs of these courageous young women will have an impact for generations to come. Our future and their future is up to us. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for being a voice for truth and courage for our future. Thank you so much, everybody. Aloha.